nothing I don't like. My family said, you know, like oysters. Yeah, I love oysters. You name it. Pig's feet. Yeah, I could eat anything. Okay, I could eat anything and I was fine. But once I hit 35, I started going up and down in my weight. I go up 10, go on physicians' weight loss, Weight Watchers. I had about, there was three weight loss centers that I had, the before and then the after picture in the lobby. But then every time I come back to another one, I'd be 10 pounds heavier than I was when I started in the first one before that. So I was yo-yoing up and down. And when I hit 40s, my indicators started to decline, all my health indicators. Now I'm getting in trouble. When I hit 50, the wheels really started falling off. My blood pressure was 145 over 95. So what did they do? They put me on meds. Okay. Well, I got to back up. For 18 years before I left this field and went into teaching theology up at Liberty Catholic for another 18, where for first 20 years I was a hospital administrator. I managed hospitals. Okay. And I have to tell you, there was a pill or a procedure for about anything. And I prescribed to that medicine, okay? So what do? I'm on medications to help get that blood pressure down. I was obese. My peak, I was at 230, okay? Always on those diets. I had high cholesterol. Mine was 260. And I was on more than one cholesterol medication, and they kept upping it because it kept going up, and then it dropped down a little bit, etc. Doctor said, you know what, you're pre-diabetic. Oh, no, you're not pre-diabetic. Now you're diabetic. And then before you know it, for years, I was on medications that they just adjusted. I didn't know you could cure type 2 diabetes 100% of the time. I just was being managed, okay? I suffered from chronic, and I always get it wrong. You get it right this time, Polly. Prima fascia. No. Plantar fasciitis. Plantar fasciitis, not a rug. That's where down here, and when you wake up in the morning, and you get out of bed, and you're heading to the bathroom, and you're going, ow, because your feet hurt so much. That's constant chronic inflammation. Plantar fasciitis, okay? Suffered from sleep apnea, snored like a freight train. Sluggish all the time. I had a cup of coffee in my hand constantly. Especially when I was at the hospital, I'd go down to the emergency room where they had the never clean, never emptied coffee pot. So I'd cut through the emergency room, fill up my coffee, and head on to the next place. Constantly drinking coffee to keep going, okay? I had serious digestive issues, either one way or another. I mean, one minute I'm all backed up, next minute I clear a room in 30 seconds. Just that bad. There was pills for everything. Then I turned 55 years old, and I started feeling some twinges. So I went to my buddy cardiologist and said, I need something here. They did some assessment. They said, yes, you do. You've got some blockages in there. They put in two stents. Now I'm getting serious. I've got to change my life, all right? And so what am I going to do? I'm going to go to page 2. I start focusing. I'm losing weight, lost about 20-some pounds. I'm following the American Heart Association diet, which I do not recommend anybody follow because it's a joke. It's like going from 99, 100 miles an hour at that brick wall. It'll slow you down to about 80. Okay, so that's it. Huge compromise. They went from what they knew was right, and they wouldn't go pull the trigger and do what was right. Still angry about that. I was at that point on 13 different meds, doing all the right things. I'm starting to exercise more, I'm eating the American Heart Association diet, losing the weight. Then what happened? October 4th, 2008, 6 months later, after my stents, I got crushing chest pains, just like what Polly was talking about Dr. Joe Crow. What do you do? Well, they gave me, after the stents, they gave me the nitro pills. Got them here somewhere. I always carry them. Never used these yet. Not these, but there they are. And I was out in Port Clinton, Ohio, and I started getting these pest pains, and they got worse. So I took a nitro pill. That might help, okay? That didn't help much. Not at all. So I took a second nitro pill. Does anybody know what the rule is after you take your second one? Well, they told me after two, call an ambulance, right? So I took three. I took three. Then I took four. Yeah. And then my brother's driving me. And I wasn't going to stop at the one hospital because they were just going to life flight me to another one. So we kept on going. I took five. My brother was afraid I had so much nitro in me, and if he had a bump, I'd explode. It was that bad. Right? So went in. They immediately rushed me in, into the hospital. In and they're running all the tests and everything else, right? Well, my cardiac surgeon says to me, we need to get you in right now, okay? Now. But the problem is you're on all these meds, but we still got to do the surgery because you're not going to likely make it through the night. But I can't do the surgery. I've been in the suite for, oh, I forget how many hours straight he had been. He goes, so we got this doc, this surgeon, he's good. He'll be able to help you. And the whole time the doctor's doing this, and he's reading, he's not saying a word to me. And finally he goes over to the other doctor and says, I'll kill him. I can't do this. So we made a deal. I had just been anointed by my pastor and my brother. I didn't have my brother-in-law as a priest. I didn't have the heart to tell my brother-in-law I've already been anointed, so I got two. I got anointed twice. Yeah, way too good too. And I said, I'm going to make it through the night if you'll do the surgery. And he goes, deal. So I had to make it through the night. I did, in case you're wondering. And I made it through the surgery, which was really going to be touch and go too. He didn't give me much of a chance. But he says, you got a chance. But he goes, ah. He says, this is going to be a tough one. And I did it. I got through it. All right? Now, the good news is, not only that, I went through all the rehab and all that kind of stuff. And I was still on, at that time, I think 16 medications. I got it written down here, but it's close. All right? For other heart issues, you know, for other stuff. And, of course, I had on angina pain. And I could walk, but I couldn't go up steps for some reason. I couldn't go to the second floor of the school building because I would get to the top, and if there wasn't anybody around, then I'd pull out a nitro pill. It would really start to hurt, and then it would go away. Now, but I'm doing all the right things still. I'm losing more weight. I ended up, by the way, having five bypasses. So I had quintuple bypass surgery is what they ended up doing for me. Two stents, then 6 months later, five bypass surgeries. Okay. Now, I go through the rehab, et cetera, and I go for the follow-up. You know, it's a six-month or five-month doctor visit with your cardiologist so he can say goodbye. Okay, you're good, that kind of thing. And he brings up something that he said he told me. Must have been while I was still under the anesthesia. because I don't remember anybody ever telling me this. He goes, you know, if it wasn't for that, you know, that picture of that lower anterior, descending anterior, lower left descending anterior artery. He said, went for that one, you'd be in great shape. Unfortunately, you couldn't do anything with that one. I said, what? What do you mean you couldn't do anything? He goes, yeah, it's 80% block, and when it goes, you go. He didn't have the best pet sight, of course. So I'm like, what? He goes, and this is not true either, but as a cardiologist, this is what he was trained, cardiac surgeon, he says, you know, it is a progressive disease. Not true. So he says, yeah, and I've got the world's worst genetics. I have my brother Dan had the world's, what's that, Guinness Book of World Records, most procedures done before he died. On his every experimental thing you can imagine at that time. He had over 100 procedures. Oh. He died, by the way, from cardiac issues. I had both parents. I had a grandparent. I have, since then, I have two brothers. They all had heart issues as well. So I knew that the genetic thing was not in my favor. So I said to him, well, there's got to be something that you could do. There's got to be some procedure because we're Americans. We've got procedures for everything. Got to be some medication to slow it down. He goes, maybe get 5-6 years before it's gone, before you're gone. Maybe. Then we were arguing. I got mad. And then what he did, since this is interesting, he looked around. Where did you see him? What? This big? Yeah. This wouldn't even fit in an exam room, right? He's looking around like there's other people in here. And then he closes the door and he sits down. He said, well, there's this guy that's done Hesselstein. This guy that's wrote a book and he's done some stuff with diet that I don't know, but it might help. Well, what's the book? I don't know. But it's on heart. It's on heart disease. And he's a cardiac surgeon. And a darn good one, by the way. It saved my life. So I did some research, and I found Esselstyn's book, Prevent Reverse Heart Disease. I got it. I got it the next day. Had it shipped over the next day. I read it, and I read it a second time. Highlighted the heck out of it, etc., etc. And then I had some questions after reading it twice, and I called him. What doctor's going to answer the phone, right? Who's going to get back to you? Well, I called him, and he was busy. Less than an hour later, he calls me back. So, is this really you? And he talked to me for quite a while. I answered all my questions. I was like, questions like, is it healthy to, for? What about fish oil? Those fish oil tablets and stuff like that. Can I take those? And he would say something like, well, I suppose you could, but I wouldn't. He says, why don't you just have 2 tablespoons of flaxseed, ground flaxseed in your oatmeal then? That'll do it just as well, and it's plant-based, et cetera, and you won't have the negative effects of that oil. You know? Those are the kinds of questions I had. I went plant-based that moment because he said, I can pretty much guarantee you if you go 100%, now I'm not his patient, and I called him about 5 times, they kept reminding me, now you know him. You're not a patient. It's free. worked out for me. He said, you have to either follow it 100% or don't even call. Either you're in 100% or you're not. Because he said, just what you said, Doc, moderation will kill you. He said, but I can pretty well assure you your diabetes will go away. You'll get off most of your medications, if not all of them, and you will stop your progression of your heart disease. Well, just like that second patient, within a month or less, I just all of a sudden realized I could go up the steps up at Lurie Cath again, the second floor, and not have any angina pain. Done with that. I was in 3 weeks, I think it was, John, my family practitioner said, we got to get you in here. We got to modify your medications. The medications are not doing you good for your diabetes. It was like within a week, I wasn't feeling good. And it was because I was taking the medications and he got me off of that. And then I'm diabetes free. All that stuff real fast. Now I'll cut to the chase. I told you what my blood pressure was before. After about 6 months, it was 110 over 70. Pretty normal, pretty darn normal. My total cholesterol after just a few months, total cholesterol. What was it, the Papua Indians? Something like that. My total cholesterol went from 260 something to 86. Total. Took several a couple of months, but 86. LDL 34, HDL 52. Now, I've had that done several times. That's been since 2014. In 15, it was 86 again. It went up to 88 once, but then it dropped back down. So, weight between I float to 170, 175, right around there. BMI now normal. My physiological age is 40, and I'm 66, going to be 67. My three-minute cardio pulse recovery test is excellent. I spin 2 to 3 times a week. I bike 100 miles a week in the summertime when the weather permits. I go cross-country skiing in the winter, and I can handle the cold that I could not handle, real cold weather when I breathe in.
I drop like a rock for some reason. I don't understand what that means. I've got energy, all that stuff. I kayak a lot. I'm now into hiking. I'm going, preparing myself for next year to do a long hike. Long hike for me. 500-mile hike.
Oh, wow.
I'm going to do the Camino de France.
Oh, nice.
That's my plan. That's my plan, okay? And I got to be in shape for that, so I got to lose another 5 pounds. But that's what happened. Now, all these doctors that Dr. Pauly talked about, Esselstyn, what's his name, Neil Barnard, John McDougall, I could go on and on and on. Their results, as John McDougall says, Dr. McDougall says, these are the results you should expect. It's not like the television commercials that say you can lose 35 pounds in 2 weeks if you take this pill, and they have somebody saying, I lost 27, I lost, you know, that kind of thing. And then at the end it says, results may not be typical. No, it's just the opposite with this. You go plant-based, you should expect these kinds of results. These kinds of results. Oh, 2.5 years later, I had to have an angio done to see, just to see. Now, they said how do you put it? Because we'd like to do one for our records. Long story short, I said, all right, I don't know what people put those types of things in those places, but I'll let you do it because I really wanted to know. And my anterior, left descending anterior main artery did not progress one bit, but it went the other way. And I went from an 80% blockage to, according to them, less than 10%. And that's why I thought it was good. Okay. A couple other things. Like what Doc said, you know, that the endothelium, the endothelial cells, the nitric oxide, there's a certain football coach in the Cleveland area. It's a major football power at that school, happens to be Keg School, will be left nameless. They're champions a lot, state champions a lot. Put several of his football players through the brachial assessment. And exact same results, but only he had them go to McDonald's. They went to that Arches place, you know, and they had the exact same results. And so he's thinking, do not give my team any meat minimum of 6 hours before a football game. Yeah. And then he took it another level. He's got into diet, this guy. And he found out that instead of doping, bicyclists, et cetera, to people so they can have the energy at the end to keep their energy up. That's all nitric oxide. Okay, so they take the blood, pull it out, and put it back in with the nitric oxide better. Okay, so they recover faster. Well, instead of doping, which is illegal, he wouldn't do that anyhow. But he found a better advantage, and it's to give beet juice to his football players so that they're stronger and have in the fourth quarter. So there's all sorts of interesting things you can learn by going plant-based. And I guess the final lesson is what you finished with. There's no side effects. It can only be better. There's no such thing as becoming protein deficient. Never been a medical case diagnosed of vegans being plant-based, being protein deficient. Never been one. Never been a diagnosed case. Unless they were starving to death. But then they're everything. And there you go. That's my story.
Thank you.
How many medications were you on before and how many are on now?
I'm none.
Well, how many before?
What?
16. How many before?
16. 16 or 18. I can't.
All right. Thank you very much, Deacon Pitt. He is going to stick around.
Yeah.
So we do want you to have the opportunity to ask questions. But we want to get folks eating and moving here as we're...
One last thing I'll pick up too is there are a billion YouTube videos out there on how to cook anything. I was a gourmet heart attack cook, and I became a gourmet plant-based cook.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, I don't miss it. I don't miss it now. I can even make things like crazy things like barbecued ribs. Now, they're a bit labor intensive, but you can make almost anything. Most of the stuff is easy, easy peasy to make. You just have to know how to substitute it. And getting the oil out, that's what silt pads are for. That's what parchment paper's for, so you don't have to put any of that stuff on it. And you can caramelize onions just exactly the same in taste by just using a little bit of water and keep moving those onions around until they're just like if you put them in oil. It's mostly habit. You just got to change your habit and you change your cooking ways, and I guarantee you, take a month or two, but after that you'll learn all the secrets and you're on your way.